What a shock. Barkley picked Auburn. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. ESPN College Football presented by Cars.com. Part of ESPN Rivalry Series presented by GoPro. Florida State looks to continue its march towards the BCS National Championship game as the Seminoles visit Gainesville to face rival Florida. The Gators suffering through their worst season in over 30 years, and today they face Jameis Winston, the leading candidate for the Heisman Trophy. He's also part of an ongoing investigation into a sexual assault complaint. No charges have been filed, and there is no change in his playing status. We'll see him shortly, but Florida will get the football first as the Gators try to end a six-game losing streak. They will not be playing in a bowl game. That ends the longest streak in FBS of 22 consecutive years. This is their bowl game, and it's against their rivals. We'll see if they rise up and play like the team we saw early in the year when they were a top 10 squad to start the season. Roberto Aguayo will kick it deep for Florida State. And Luchez Purifoy, they fake the reverse. And Purifoy is stood up at the 25-yard line. One of the reasons why Florida has lost six in a row, they have been decimated by injuries, including losing their quarterback, Jeff Driscoll, week three to a broken leg against Tennessee, and Dominic Easley, their all-world defensive lineman.
Now, when you look at the injuries, though, most of them have been on the offensive side. Three offensive tackles. You mentioned Matt Jones, and then two quarterbacks, Jeff Driscoll and Tyler Murphy, who will not play in this game for a shoulder injury. It will be an uphill battle for Florida on the offensive side.
So freshman Skylar Morningwig making his third start, throws it out in the flat to Pat, and he is wrapped up by Christian Jones for a loss of about four on the play. As we look at today's impact players, brought to you by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry.
And that was Christian Jones on that tackle. Two of the best defensive players in all of college football play for Florida State, Christian Jones and LaMarcus Joyner. And Kelvin Taylor, the halfback for Florida, has been really the only spark plug outside of Solomon Pat on this offense in the last 6 weeks.
Still second down and 14 for the Gators. And here's Taylor, can't find a hole, wrapped up by Timmy Jernigan. So it'll bring up third down and long. So with Driscoll out and the injury to Tyler Murphy, Morningwig, whose father Marty is with the Philadelphia Eagles, former head coach of the Detroit Lions, against Georgia Southern last week, threw for only 122 yards. They lost that game. First time in school history they lose to an FCS opponent.
And Morningwig has to be smart in this game, not try to do too much. Right off the bat, a third and 15 here, backed up inside your own 25-yard line. It's got to be smart. Turnovers on offense for Florida could lead to a blowout.
Morningwig with time and underneath. It's caught at the 30-yard line, but short of the first down. There's Ahmad Fullwood, so they'll make it a little bit easier for their punter. But Florida goes three and out in its opening drive.
And really the question coming into this game was the matchup of Jameis Winston against this Florida defense. We'll get our first chance to take a look. But Florida defensively, despite how bad the season has gone for Florida, they have still been consistent. They're the second-ranked defense in the SEC and number one against the pass. So it'll be a challenge for Jameis Winston.
On the 25-yard line, it's pulled in and then tackled immediately. Kenny Shaw wrapped up by Cody Riggs, the gunner. And so Florida State will start just shy of its 25. Jameis Winston, will it be two straight years where a freshman wins the Heisman Trophy? Johnny Manziel last year, who replaced a first-round pick in Ryan Tannehill. Jameis Winston replaces a first-round pick in E.J. Manuel. And his team is undefeated, trying to go 12-0 for the first time since 1999, their national championship season. Winston to the air on first down. Devontae Freeman tackled in the open field by Darren Kitchens after a short gain.
I think the biggest thing with Jameis Winston and talking with Jimbo Fisher, everybody talks about his size and his arm strength and the leadership. Really, he's been one of the most accurate quarterbacks in college football this year, and I believe that's been one of the biggest reasons for such success that he's had. Now, it'll be different to see. He's going to need that accuracy against the Florida defensive backs who play man coverage on every snap.
We went to a practice early in the year, and the ball never hit the ground. Benjamin wrapped up and brought down for a loss. It was Purifoy. And a little extracurricular activity. No shock in this rivalry. Let's check in with Tom Luganville for Florida's impact players on defense.
Well, there's no question that the best defensive secondary Florida State will face all year long is the Florida Gators. Whether it's Marcus Roberson, Luchez Purifoy, or the true freshman Vernon Hargraves, they will challenge Kelvin Benjamin, Kenny Shaw, and Rashad Green all day long.
And a third down and long for Winston and the Seminole. Florida bringing pressure, and Winston's pass is caught for a first down at the 40-yard line by Rashad Green. Now, the ball came out, but they ruled that forward progress was stopped at the 35.
You mentioned pressure from Florida defensively. Two backers on the inside. Great pickup flush by that offensive line. Jameis Winston all year has had perfect pockets to throw from, and then here it is, the hand battle on the outside. Hargraves against Green. That time Green wins by a little.
Winston grew up in Alabama, didn't know much about this Florida State-Florida rivalry, as his pass is dropped by Devontae Freeman, a shot by Brian Poole, but there's a penalty flag in the backfield, likely on Florida here for the hit on Winston.
Well, you want Florida to come out aggressive with
personal
passion.
Foul, roughing the passer, number 55 on the defense.
But you don't want to have penalties like this, and it's a fine line. And Darius Cummings comes in, balls out, and he takes three steps before he hits Jameis Winston. And that's that fine line that you want that passion, but you want to be smart too.
Florida State doesn't need any help. They're pretty good without the penalties. They've scored more than 40 points in 11 straight games. That's an NCAA record for a single season. The all-time mark is 13 straight games over two seasons with 40 or more points. Winston stepping up, airing it out. And it's broken up and picked off by Purifoy. What a play by Luchez Purifoy. And Winston turns it over.
Something good has to happen for Florida to start this game, and the matchup to watch throughout the game are the wide receivers against the defensive backs for Florida. Purifoy gets away with a little. Maybe that's the way the officials are going to call this game. Physical start for Florida.
Chez Purifoy, one of the playmakers on this Florida defense, and he intercepts Jameis Winston, just the eighth pick for Winston this year.
Florida's defense is going to be in position if they play man-to-man coverage most of this game. The question is going to be, can Florida State make the plays that are tight? That time Green didn't make it. Ball was a little bit underthrown. Ronald Powell, the defensive end for Florida, got a little bit of pressure, got around Cam Irving, got a hand on Winston, and he had to step up. Either way, the ball was underthrown, and a great play by Purifoy.
Florida ball on its 13-yard line with Skyler Morningwig at quarterback. And they'll hand it off here to Kelvin Taylor, true freshman, son of Fred Taylor, who was on that Florida team in 97 that upset number one Florida State and helped Michigan win the national championship.
I think Taylor's got to be featured in this game, as well as Trey Burton. And I think we can expect from Brent Pease, the offensive coordinator, who's been under a lot of scrutiny lately, a lot of the wildcat. And we're just going to start right now with Trey Burton at quarterback. You can't depend on Skyler Morningwig to throw the football and beat Florida State.
They bring Showers in motion. And here's Burton out of the wildcat with a big seam. In the Florida State territory, inside the 35-yard line.
Just the threat of Valdez Showers in motion, and his speed opens up the inside for Trey Burton. Take a look, run it, guys. You're going to see Valdez Showers come in motion. That takes the linebacker Smith in. He gets the crease on the inside, and Trey Burton shows you he's got a little bit of wiggle left. It's playing his last game in the Florida Gators uniform. A great start.
His 11th carry of the season. And it's a 50-yard run to the Florida State 33-yard line. Back to Taylor. Gang tackled at the 31-yard line, a gain of two. Terrence Smith leading the way. Will Muschamp in his third year led Florida to a BCS bowl game, the Sugar Bowl last year, and obviously a struggle this year at 4-7. We spoke with him this week and talked to Jeremy Foley on the phone, the athletic director, and Foley said Will Muschamp will be our head coach. In fact, Foley used the words saying that they're in a foxhole with Will Muschamp. He's not going anywhere, but there will be some changes. High snap. Burton able to corral and then brought down for a loss. Firing into the backfield to make the play was Terrence Brooks. So it brings up third down and long.
Well, that's what you want your athletic director to do, right, is to be in that foxhole with you. And I think it's shown a lot of courage, quite frankly, on the part of Jeremy Foley, and I've been impressed with the way that Will Muschamp has handled everything that's gone on the last 6 weeks. Certainly on the field, it hasn't been what he wanted, but he hasn't made excuses. We know about the injuries, and they've started this game, at least in the first couple of series, coming out and playing with energy and passion that they didn't last week against Georgia Southern.
Third down and 11. Morningwig in trouble, and he does get back to the original line of scrimmage. It would make it about a 50-yard field goal try for Frankie Velez, whose season long is 44. And let's see if they try the field goal or if they punt the ball here. And they're going to bring in Austin Harden, who's got a long of 33 on the year. He's 4 of 11 on field goal tries, but they're going to bring him in instead of Velez. He's also had a field goal attempt blocked. A 49-yard field goal try to get Florida on the board. It's been almost 500 minutes of game action since Florida State trailed. And it's no good. So a 50-yard run by Trey Burton, but the Gators unable to capitalize. Harden misses from 49, and we're still scoreless midway through the first. No score after a missed 49-yard field goal, and Florida State is back on offense after a Jameis Winston interception. Dave Pasch alongside Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville down on the field. What does Florida have to do to be in this game in the fourth quarter?
Well, they got to come in with the right attitude, right? You got to sell out on defense. That's your best unit. You've got to strip the football, play the ball in the air, man-to-man coverage, which Pierre Floyd just did. And then you have got to match the intensity, which they had early in this game. And you can't, if you're a defensive player for Florida, you can't depend on your offense to come out and score 25, 28 points. You have got to get the ball on defense. If the ball's on the ground or in the air, you got to intercept it, pick it up, and score. You got to have that attitude, I think, if you're going to stay in this game.
Trey Burton had a 50-yard run, then had to leave the game because of an injury. We'll keep you updated on his status. Second down and 9 after a 1-yard gain. Pressure coming. Winston and drop by Benjamin in midfield. So it'll bring up third down and long. He's been pretty good this year. 36 catches, 9 touchdowns, and he might have had number 10. He had a head of steam.
Absolutely. Great pickup of the blitz. Jameis Winston sees it, puts that ball right on the money, and Kelvin Benjamin just a little bit of lapse in focus there. As he's wide open, perfectly run route. They got a rub against man-to-man coverage. And so far early in this game, defensively, Florida has been up to the challenge.
See if they come after Winston here. Third down and long. Winston, and there's a flag. Intended for Kenny Shaw and Vernon Hargraves III, who's had a terrific season as a true freshman, was all over him, so an easy call, pass interference, and an automatic first down.
Well, Kenny Shaw is the slot receiver. He's got great feet, very difficult to cover man-to-man.
On the defense, number one. That's a 10-yard penalty with an automatic first down.
But Vernon Hargraves is one of the best cover corners in college football, even as a true freshman. Wasn't pass interference there. The question is, when he came out of that break, did he tug on his jersey a little bit?
Because they ruled holding, which means it was before the throw. The first down for Florida State. Winston, 3 of 5 passing with an interception so far. Comes in the leading candidate for the Heisman Trophy. Devontae Freeman wrapped up in the backfield, but somehow squirted out of there and got positive yards. A gain of about 3 as we say hello to Reese Davis in the studio.
All right, guys, time for a Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. Duke playing North Carolina. Duke wins. They go to the ACC championship game. Marquise Williams in at quarterback. The injured Bren Renner hurt a few weeks ago, and Eric Ebron. Ebron is loose. Didn't quite make it to the end zone, but the Tar Heels have scored first. 7-0 North Carolina.
And, of course, Florida State will be in the ACC title game next week as Winston airs it out. What a catch by O'Leary at the 30-yard line. A terrific grab by Nick O'Leary, his 28th reception.
O'Leary was matched up on Cody Riggs, the safety, and O'Leary's big enough at 250 pounds that he, the top of his route just gets away with a little bit of push on Cody Riggs, and that makes an outstanding grab. Don't see many old school guys without the gloves and the pads and all that.
He's one of them, 24-yard pass play at the Florida 30-yard line. Winston leads the nation in pass efficiency, trying to break Russell Wilson's FBS record. Here's Freeman on the toss. Knocked down inside the 25-yard line by Jalen Watkins, but that's a good pickup on first down, about 4.
This is the area of the field where Jimbo Fisher and Jameis Winston love to take shots at the end zone. The 25-yard line, the fringe area. You can still have play action and throw the ball in the end zone. Florida's got to be ready for it.
Freeman bounces off one tackler and slammed to the ground by Ronald Powell. Again, pushing and shoving after the play. So a 1-yard pickup, another third down here for Florida State, coming in number 2 behind Alabama in the BCS standing.
And now a 3rd and 6. Traditionally a blitz down for Will Muschamp in this Florida defense. They've been outstanding on third downs throughout the course of the year, but they're going against Jameis Winston, who's one of the best quarterbacks in all of college football, throwing the ball on third down against the blitz.
We talked about his accuracy, 5th in the country at 70%. 3rd down and 5. Winston, little pressure, and he's sacked at the 33-yard line. Nerron Ball gets to the quarterback. It's 4th down. And they might be out of field goal range at the 33-yard line.
Well, here's Ball right here. You're going to see him. He's going to come, and Freeman's going to try to pick him up. He picks him up initially, and that's all you can ask from a back, is to get that one hit on a linebacker, and then that ball has to come out. But the man-to-man coverage downfield forced Jameis Winston to pull it down. It comes up with a big sack.
Roberto Aguayo has missed 1 kick all year. Field goals, extra points. 1 kick, as long as 53. This is a 49-yarder. And he'd have made that thing from 59. Wow. The freshman, Roberto Aguayo, now 16 of 17 on field goals this season. So a missed 49-yarder by Florida. A made 49-yard field goal by the Seminoles. And they have the first quarter lead on the road. He absolutely crushed that thing.
ESPN College Football is presented by Cars.com. Get the right car without all the drama. Cars.com. All drive, no drama. And in part by Dave & Buster's. Eat, drink, play. Watch sports.
Some shots of the Sunshine Showdown between Florida, Florida State, 97, when the Gators were ranked 10th. The Seminoles were the number 1 team in the country. Florida won that game, and the guy next to me has a nice shiny ring on his finger. And it may not be there if Florida State wins that game.
Really?
Wins a national title.
Really? Is that where you're going to go?
Yeah.
That has nothing to do with that game. It has to do with the other game going on right now, though.
I
won't even tell you the score there. I don't know it, though, actually. Purifoy on the return. Past the 25-yard line to the 27. Christian Jones on kick coverage.
You're
makes the tackle.
You're unbelievable.
Dave Pashbron, Greasy Tom Luganville in Gainesville. Florida State on top 3-0. Florida was in position perhaps for a field goal after Trey Burton out of the Wildcat with a 50-yard run, but he was injured on the play, and this has been the story for the Gators all year. 14 players, 8 starters with season-ending injuries, and you wonder if Burton will return in his final game as a Gator after going to the locker room following that play.
Yeah, it looked like he came down hard on that left shoulder. He wasn't moving that arm as he walked off. Would change this offense for Florida and what they wanted to do specifically in this game potentially drastically without Burton.
Here's Mack Brown on the carry and doesn't get much. Christian Jones made the hit.
Well, Florida knows they can't win this football game behind the arm of Skylar Morningwig. They've got to have some ingenuity in the offense. And that ingenuity was about the Wildcat. It was about Trey Burton. So now you're going to look at number 10, Valdez Showers. You're going to look at number 21, the true freshman, Kelvin Taylor, and how they can maybe take over that role, because that's the option principle and the zone read looks that this offense has to have to create some problems for Florida State defensively.
They got 2 yards in that previous play, Tom. Second down and 8. Morningwood has time. And the pass was woefully underthrown, but it is caught by Clay Burton for a first down. You know, Brian, Brent Pease, the offensive coordinator, has been criticized for a lack of creativity. Hard to tell from that angle whether he trapped it. And think about it. Pease came from Boise State where they were known for creativity. But this has been an offense that really struggled. 111th in the country this year, 103rd last year, and 105th in 2011 when Charlie Weiss was the offensive coordinator.
And you got to have the pieces, right? I mean, you can't lose 3 tackles, your starting tailback, your top 2 quarterbacks, and hide behind the veil of got to be innovative, right? It's hard to be innovative. You don't have the players.
Here's Mack Brown shaking a tackle and getting up for the 45. Was surprised they didn't blow it dead there just to take a look. They must have been sure that it was a catch.
But last year they won 11 games. And they averaged 150 yards a game passing, and they still won 11 games. And what Will Muschamp will tell you is, as a coaching staff, they didn't get dumb overnight. Right? And so I think part of it is a lack of innovation. Part of it, most of it, is the injuries. But now when you lose Trey Burton and you're not able to run the Wildcat in this game, it's going to put him even more behind the eight ball.
Here's a screen to Showers. Got blockers out there. Showers went down awkwardly at the 46-yard line. A 2-yard pickup. Third down.
You know, the run game for Florida, and talking to Brent Pease in pregame warm-up, I asked him point blank. I said, what are you going to have to do to try and move this football in the run game? And he said, quite honestly, I don't think Florida State's been challenged at the point of attack the way I believe that we could challenge them. Am I saying we're going to run up the field up and down on them? No. But I do think that we're big and we can lean on them, but we're going to have to count on these backs to find some creases and really press this Florida State defense, put them in a phone booth, which opponents prior to this game have not been able to do.
Well, see here, you would assume a pass play on third down and 5. Florida went for 2 on third down. Here comes pressure. Morningwig. Oh, and it was dropped. Morningwig did well despite taking a hit to get rid of that pass. But it was dropped by Solomon Patton.
Well, you have a young quarterback, and you're going to get pressure. LaMarcus Joyner's going to come off the edge. Christian Jones off the edge. Both of them at the same time. And Joyner comes free. Gets a big hit on the quarterback.
Solomon Patton, who's probably been the best and most consistent offensive player for Florida, drops one. Needed to make that play for his quarterback. Good punt. And I think it was touched and then goes into the end zone. A touchback. So come out to the 20-yard line as we check in with Reese in the studio.
All right, guys, Taco Bell studio update. Michigan had put together the first 99-yard touchdown drive against Ohio State in 10 years. But Braxton Miller answers to Devin Smith for the score. And they are locked up at 7. It's on ABC. Buckeyes trying to remain undefeated.
Wow, so Michigan with a 99-yard touchdown drive against the Buckeyes, but Braxton Miller able to bounce back. Tied up at 7 there, 3-0 here. Florida State on top, closing seconds of the opening quarter. Jameis Winston will hand it off to Freeman, and he gets slammed down on the backfield by Darius Cummings. Florida State so far has not been able to run the football on this Florida front seven.
Well, and not a lot of teams have been able to run the football on this front seven. I mean, this is a defense. They lost a lot of players from a year ago, and they've lost Dominique Easley, their best defensive player from this year. But the emergence of some of the players like Ronald Powell and Dante Fowler, Leon Orr, they have stepped it up, and in the first part, early part of this game, they have certainly matched the intensity.
It's the most adversity Florida State has faced in a couple of months, and they have the lead. 3-0 over Florida after one here in Gainesville.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the WatchESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Great football all day, all night on ESPN and ABC. At 7:45, Missouri is in the SEC championship game if it can beat Texas A&M on ESPN. On ABC, UCLA and USC in the battle for the victory bell. Here in Gainesville, Florida State with 33 yards of offense in the first quarter and 3 points. This team averages 44 points per game. Winston in trouble steps up. And down he goes after getting about 3 yards. Darius Cummings with another tackle, so it'll bring up a third down and long here.
It's the third time in this game where Florida defensively has had the coverage downfield. Jameis Winston has not felt comfortable pulling the trigger, and the rush has gotten to him. Another situation here on third and seven where you expect the same thing from Florida. Tight man coverage and pressure up front.
Just a correction on the staff. Florida State averaging 55 points per game. They're outscoring teams by 44 points per game. That's the best in college football the last decade. Winston hit, gets rid of the ball. And down at the 21, one official says incomplete. The other says a sack. Pressure by Neron Ball. And they rule it incomplete, but it's fourth down anyway, and they'll punt.
Rolling on the field, it's an incomplete forward pass. Fourth down.
They ran a good stunt on the outside. They bring Ball off the edge, and Dante Fowler, number 6, wraps around. He flushes Winston, and Ball is the beneficiary. But right now, Jameis Winston and this offensive line, which has been solid all year, is rattled by this front seven for Florida.
We talked about the fact that they haven't faced really any adversity. And even though they've got the lead, this is a little bit of adversity given how physical Florida's been on the defensive line against Florida State's offensive line. And the Gators have some momentum even though they trail 3-0.
Believe it or not, plays right into the strength of the Florida defense, which is coverage downfield. Take a look at what Jameis Winston's looking at. Where are you going to throw that ball? Tight man-to-man coverage. And then up front, Florida, with the intensity, is getting to the quarterback. You got to think about, Dave, last week, this Florida defense gave up 400 yards on the ground, over 400 yards on the ground to Georgia Southern. And Will Muschamp had all week to talk to his defense. He's made it personal early in this game. Their Florida defense, with the talent that they have, attacking Jameis Winston and this offense. And so far, they've been very successful.
Georgia Southern didn't complete a pass in that game. Didn't need to, as you said, because of the lack of run defense by Florida. Best starting field position for the Gators as Patton gets it on the end around and run out of bounds by Terrence Brooks. So a negative play on first down. They're only averaging a yard on first down.
Well, we introduced our impact matchups as being those Florida corners against Florida State's receivers. There's nowhere to go with the ball downfield, Brian. And as you referenced, you got to get the ball out under pressure. You've got to know where to go to your hots, where your side adjusts are. But as I'm looking at things from the field level here, Florida is not only physically getting after Florida State, they are mentally wearing them down. And they're getting after him with some confusion and some exotic looks, walking guys up into the gap, creating problems.
Florida State's defense, though, is playing well. 3 yard setback for Florida. Pressure coming. Morningwig has it complete. as Dunbar is wrapped up right away by Jalen Ramsey. Secondary for Florida State's pretty good too. He did get back to the line of scrimmage. But another third down and long facing the Gators.
Yeah, well, two good defenses playing this game. Florida State giving up only 11 points a game, second in the country. We knew coming in the game plan for Florida was to try to play the kind of defense they're known for, which is suffocating, and then try to get something on offense. They want to make this a 10-6 kind of game. And so far, it's been a struggle on offense like we anticipated.
And coming out of the stance, Max Garcia, the left tackle.
False start on the offense. Number 74 and number 76, the 5-yard penalty, third down.
So both tackles who haven't been starters. DJ Humphreys was a starter at left tackle. He's out with a knee, and Tyler Moore at right tackle is out with an elbow injury.
When you have a new quarterback, this happens. Get used to one quarterback's cadence, and that time both offensive tackles were off early.
This is where you got to be smart here. Third down and long into Florida. Can't have a turnover against Florida State. And the pass is caught right short of the marker by Dunbar by a yard. We'll see. Does Florida take a chance here and go for it in their own territory on fourth down? A losing season. This is it. This is their final game. Well, Muschamp is thinking about it.
Even if they don't, this is big for Florida's quarterback, Skyler Morningweg, just to get him some confidence, backed up on third down and long to make that kind of a throw. And, yeah, I think you're right. Will Muschamp, he knows that he has got to create some time of possession, and he's going to go for it here.
I'm surprised that he's going to call timeout to talk about it. Surprised they're not going to stop and look at it a little bit longer here, because, boy, you can challenge a spot with respect to a first down. It's fourth down right now. Back in a moment. In college football, Florida State in Florida. The Seminoles with a 3-0 lead, and Florida on fourth down and one from its own 42, electing to go for it. Joyer in front of Taylor. And Taylor got the first down as the Gators able to lean on the Noles front four and move the chains.
I love the call from Will Muschamp, just because I want to see these guys come off the ball. They're playing great. Look at Joyer get a block on the edge on Mario Edwards. Their defensive line is playing fantastic. Challenge this offensive line to match the intensity of their defense on a fourth down call backed up in your own end. They got it.
Florida State two wins away from playing for the BCS National Championship. Only leading 3-0 here as Morningweg is chased. Incomplete as LaMarcus Joyner, who's a finalist for the Bronco Nagurski Award, goes to the best overall defensive player in college football. Not a big guy, 5'8", 190. But you said early in the year when we had Florida State that you thought he was one of the best defensive players in the country.
He's not just one of the best defensive players in the country. He's one of the best players, period. And people should be talking about him going to New York for the Heisman Trophy. I played with a guy named Charles Woodson that played a little bit of offense and special teams. But LaMarcus Joyner is playing that position for Florida State, blitzing. If he played special teams and a little bit of offense, he'd be in the conversation.
Morningweg on second and 10, throws complete to Patton. He's wrapped up immediately by P.J. Williams. A gain of about four, at least that gives Skyler Morningweg a manageable third down. He's actually looked poised so far.
Well, I think what's happened here early in this game is Brent Pease, the offensive coordinator, wanted to use some of the wildcat with Trey Burton. Now that Burton is out, they've had to adjust and really use Morningweg. You're going to have to throw the ball quick. Pease didn't feel like he could block this front for Florida State in the passing game for a long time, so the ball has to come out in the quick passing game.
He's 7-9, Morningweg, for 42 yards. On third down, Florida State coming with a blitz. Morningweg being chased. and throws it away. So fourth down. Jacoby McDaniel was chasing Morningwig, and the Gators now will punt it.
And this is what Pease was afraid of, just coming off the edge. Trenton Brown, the tackle, and Alapio were responsible for that. There's a breakdown. Morningwig does a great job of not having a negative play there. Sack fumble, throws the football away, and now you'll get your punt for field position.
The difference in the game, a made 49-yard field goal for Florida State, a missed 49-yard field goal by Florida. Kenny Shaw, the deep man for FSU. And the Gators able to down it inside the 5-yard line. Luchez Purifoy already has an interception and a tackle for a loss and makes a big play on special teams here to back up the Noles inside the 5.
ESPN College Football brought to you by Dr. Pepper, always one of a kind. And GoPro, the world's most versatile camera. GoPro, be a hero.
Unique views from our GoPro camera with Florida trailing Florida State 3-0, but the Gators with momentum after a terrific punt by true freshman Johnny Townsend to back up Florida State inside its 5-yard line. The Noles have 39 yards of offense. 24 of those came in one play. It's been 2 months since they trailed in a game. How will the Heisman Trophy candidate handle it? Winston throws, knocked down by Purifoy, stepping in front of Kelvin Benjamin.
How will this Florida State offense respond? Kelvin Benjamin, you got to make plays against tight man coverage. Purifoy gets away with a little bit of a tug there. It's going to be tight all day, and now backed up. This kind of adversity, Jameis Winston, this is what you want to see. You want to see how the best player in college football to date this season, how he responds against one of the better defenses in college football.
Now we got a timeout called by Florida State. Winston, 4 of 8 passing, 35 yards and an interception.
Couldn't have been a better start for Florida. They had the crowd in the game, only down 3. See if Florida State can respond.
Reese Davis with you on ABC. Michigan's had the ball 3 times and scored 3 touchdowns. Devin Gardner to Jeremy Gallen. Played 30 seconds in the second quarter, and Michigan has nearly 250 yards of offense, and now they're in a fight on ABC. Coaches are separating them on the field.
Wow. Well, Florida State's in a fight, not literally, but backed up, and the swamp has come alive as Luchez Purifoy played a whale of a game so far for the Gators, and Jameis Winston, the Heisman Trophy perhaps leading candidate, just 4 of 8 passing with an interception. They only have 4 rushing yards. They're going to try to pound it here with Freeman, and he's got a hole. Right at the first down marker. Tackled by Jalen Watkins. We'll see where they spot it. Going to be short, 3rd down and 1.
That's a big play for Florida State. Backed up. Put it on the back of your offensive line. Watch them come off. You can run it, guys. Just a power play to the strong side. You get Cameron Irving. You get a block from O'Leary. And when you're backed up, you've got to be able to run the ball out of a 2-back set to give yourself some breathing room.
They got 9 yards there, their biggest run play. A 3rd down and 1. Freeman has the 1st down, diving just short of the 15. Ronald Powell in on the stop. Freeman, over 800 rushing yards this season for Florida State. We've also seen James Wilder. We'll see Carlos Williams as well. They have a lot of options at tailback.
Well, it's important now for Florida, who gave up that 1st down after they were backed up, that you don't let up on the pressure. Continue your coverage downfield and pressure in the backfield. That's what's been working.
And talking with Jimbo Fisher, nothing has fazed Jameis Winston. Not the off-the-field adversity, as Freeman is past the 20-yard line, knocked to the ground by Darren Kitchens. And when you watch Winston, you can see it, that nothing seems to faze him, even on-field adversity. Does not play like a redshirt freshman.
Well, to be fair, we haven't seen him in a whole lot of adverse situations. Yes, they were down at BC, but that's BC. This is a completely different animal on the road against one of the best defenses in the SEC.
They got 5 yards on first down, so it's second and five. Freeman again, and great job at the point of attack to get off a block and make a play. That was Ronald Powell, and Jared Davis, a true freshman who made his first start last week. They got Antonio Morrison, a linebacker, out for the year, and then Michael Taylor, their leading tackler, sprained his MCL last week and lost against Georgia Southern, and he's out today.
Well, and give this defensive line credit for coming in. And after last week, they played Georgia Southern, got cut on every single play, Leon Orr and Damian Jacobs, and they have not let that get into their head as they approach Florida State's offense this week.
2-4 on third down so far. Winston gets hit. Oh, still completed it to Freeman for a first down at the 31-yard line. Darren Kitchens put a lick on Winston. That tells you about his strength, because that pass was right on the money.
Well, they brought the blitz on the weak side with Kitchens, and the rotation allows Deontay Freeman to be open. It's great recognition from Jameis Winston of the blitz, getting rid of that ball before you get hit and knowing exactly where the weakness in the defense was.
Consecutive first downs for Florida State. 3-0 lead midway through the second quarter. Winston got a man. Benjamin can't come up with it. Incomplete. Would have been a great catch, but it was right there for Benjamin, who had a drop in the first quarter.
Well, they identify Kelvin Benjamin on Jalen Watkins, the safety. He beats him right off the line of scrimmage. Excuse me, that's Purifoy. He beats off the line of scrimmage and then gets behind him, and that ball is perfectly thrown right through the hands of Benjamin. That's the second drop, right?
He had the one in the first quarter. That was a catchable ball, certainly, and it's second down and 10. Winston now 5 of 10 passing. Winston in trouble, wrapped up, gets out of there, but now can't get away from Brian Cox Jr. Sacked near the 20-yard line. Jonathan Bullard was there first.
Yeah, Bullard just shot off the line of scrimmage. Beat the offensive line. Take a look. Here he is right here. He's just going to beat the offensive lineman. That's Bobby Hart. And you get the sense, don't you, Dave, that the intensity and the emotion is all on the side of Florida right now. They have come to play in this game, and maybe Florida State has lost a little bit of the focus and anticipated Florida just laying down in this game.
And that was a question: would Florida play with pride knowing their season's over? They're not going to a bowl game for the first time since 1990. Got a penalty marker here.
Delay a game
on the offense.
It was interesting. We asked Jimbo yesterday, what's the weakness of your team? And he said, that's a really good question. I don't know if we have one. Maybe we're seeing it here in the first half, that if you're physical with their offensive line.
Well, he hesitated. I asked him, what do you need to improve on? He couldn't find a whole lot, but certainly he's going to learn a lot about his team in this kind of environment and what they're made of down deep.
Let's see how Florida handles this. Do you come after Winston here in third and 26, or do you play it safe? They're only going to rush three. And Winston has a man. Oh, the pass is caught incredibly despite a huge hit. Kenny Shaw got leveled. It was a good hit by Riggs. And he caught it. First down.
That's as good as you can do it if you're Cody Riggs. He was cognizant of not going for the head. He led with his shoulder right into the chest. But what a play by Kenny Shaw to come up with that football. And what a throw. Let's give Jameis Winston credit. Backed up third and 26. Put it right on the money.
Well, they get 27 on third and 26. Play action. Winston going deep into coverage. And incomplete. Trying to hit Rashad Green.
It's pretty clear early in this game, Jameis Winston's going to take his shots downfield. Benjamin dropped one. That time he went for Green. if I'm Jameis Winston, I'm going to realize and respect that Florida can guard my receivers on the outside in man-to-man coverage. The real weakness of this Florida defense right now is at the linebacker position, playing a true freshman, Jared Davis. That time he had Nick O'Leary, the tight end, matched up and wide open in the middle of the field. You got to use O'Leary in these situations.
And prior to that catch by Shaw, their biggest play through the air was a pass to O'Leary. Play clock at one. They just get it off in time. Winston with time, and Florida State called a timeout. The Noles called a timeout, so they've burned two already. So just one left.
Jimbo had to call a timeout because Jameis Winston let that play clock go down to 1 second again. Lucky to get the timeout.
Get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN at 10 a.m. with Sunday NFL Countdown. Chris Berman and the gang, also a feature on Russell Wilson and his mom with a little girl he met on a recent visit to a Seattle children's hospital. And before you set your lineup, catch Fantasy Football Now, 11 a.m. on ESPN2. Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville in Gainesville, where Jameis Winston thrown for 71 yards and an interception, and just 3 points for the Seminoles, who averaged 55 points per game. Good for second in the country. He'll throw on second down and 10. Pumps. And a flag comes down. Winston still going. Gets the first down, but this is coming back. Bobby Hart was on top of Dante Fowler.
Holding on the offense, number 51.
You start to sense the first bit of frustration from this offense from Jameis Winston. Bobby Hart, he's working on Dante Fowler. He's good right there. When he goes to spin, great move by Fowler. The official sees that Bobby Hart has a hold of that jersey. That's a good call because Jameis Winston doesn't get outside without that hold.
They converted a third down and 26 on this drive, and now they got a second down and 20. This has been a five-minute drive, and look where the ball is. It's on their 32-yard line. Negative plays and penalties. 11th play of the drive, 28 yards so far. Winston with a ton of time going for Benjamin, and it's caught in Florida territory at the 45-yard line. A beautiful toss by Winston.
Purifoy was in great position again. Watch him. His shoe falls off, and he slips and falls. He's trying to get back to make a play on the ball, and he just slipped. But this is how tight these throws are going to be all game. Purifoy may have had a chance to pick that ball off had he not slipped and lost the shoe.
Still got his hand in there. But a 23-yard pass play, and the Seminoles are in Florida territory. 4.5 to go in the first half of the 3-0 lead. Winston, Benjamin again. Inside the 30, breaks a tackle. Benjamin inside the 15. Benjamin is in. Touchdown, FSU. And Jameis Winston matches the school record for touchdown passes in a single season, set by Chris Winkie when he won the Heisman in 2000. Will Winston win it in 2013?
It's a great response from Jameis Winston and from Kelvin Benjamin, who has dropped two passes already in this game, but comes back and makes two big grabs to increase this Florida State lead to 10 points.
10th touchdown grab of the year for Benjamin. 10-0 Florida State.
And Florida has been living with the blitz, and this time they're going to bring it here, and you're going to see it leaves man-to-man coverage on the weak side to Benjamin on Brian Poole, who's the reserve nickelback, and just not big enough. Poole is. He's only 205 pounds against Benjamin, who is just too big and physical. And you see that wide open lane on the inside because of those blitzing linebackers.
Benjamin has really taken a big step as a sophomore this year. Had a couple of drops earlier in this game, but some big catches on this 12-play, 96-yard drive. And now what if you're Florida? You've played your tails off on defense. You're down 10-0. Florida State has momentum back. And how can the Gators answer with the struggles they've had on offense?
Well, they're not going to find that magic offense in a bottle, if that's what you're asking. But I think Florida has played exactly the way that they wanted to play. It's just without any offense, it's going to be hard to continue to keep up with this Florida State offense. But the biggest thing out of that drive, you get the ball on the four-yard line if you're Florida State, and you persevere, you have some mistakes, you have some penalties, they overcome a third and 26. That's what is so exciting about this Florida State team and the resilience and the leadership of number five, who just refuses to lose any kind of confidence no matter what the situation.
He's now 8 of 14 for 139 yards, an interception, and a touchdown. And now Aguayo will kick it deep. Florida State will play either Duke, Virginia Tech, or Miami in the ACC championship game next week. And if it wins the next two, you would assume that Florida State will play in the BCS national championship game as the ball comes off the tee. And Ohio State is losing to Michigan right now, 21-14. You'd have to think right now, really, that there's five teams in the mix going into today, including Auburn and Missouri. Missouri plays A&M tonight on ESPN. If the Tigers win, then they'll be in the SEC championship game. If they were to win, they could vault into the discussion. So much yet to be decided. As that goes out of bounds, so it'll be very good starting field position for Florida as we check in with Reese Davis in the studio.
Time for an innovative look brought to you by AT&T. And Dave, you mentioned the fight that number two and number three are having. Number one, Alabama gets Auburn tonight, and Auburn will have to deal with A.J. McCarron. Take a look at this against LSU. McCarron sees the pressure coming and immediately knows he's got a mismatch with Amari Cooper. Now how McCarron is able to exploit the Auburn defense led by Ellis Johnson could determine how much of a fight the Tide has with the Tigers.
We saw Auburn a few weeks ago. It's amazing because they have mostly the same players from last year with the exception of Nick Marshall, the quarterback. What a turnaround.
That's an important exception. He's been their spark plug all year, and it'll be a struggle for Alabama to contain Nick Marshall.
So Florida starts at the 35 after Aguayo's kick goes out of bounds. Here's Showers on the screen, cuts it upfield, and gets to the 40-yard line for a 5-yard gain. LaMarcus Joyner on the stick. Well, let's look at today's Aflac trivia question. How many times has a team from the state of Florida appeared in the 15 BCS championship games played to date?
That's a good one.
Do you have a guess?
Do I have a guess? Well, I'm going to say, well, the first 4 or 5 years, I want to say, of the BCS contained Florida team. I'm going to say 7. See if Reese Davis can get that one.
Oh, big hit by Edwards on the ball carrier Showers, so no gain on the play. Or Mac Brown, excuse me. Mac Brown, the ball carrier. So third down coming up. 3.5 to go in the half. Florida State leading 10-0.
Third downs here is where not only do you miss Trey Burton from the Wildcat position, but you miss him from the wide receiver position as well. He was their third down target. So they're really missing Trey Burton. The substitute now has got to be Flowers, number 10. He's the one that's most electric with the ball in his hand.
Yeah, Burton, no update on him. He got hurt on a 50-yard run in the first quarter.
Comes a blitz from Florida State.
Morningweg. And Showers can't make the defender miss. Great open field play made by the corner, Ronald Darby, and that forces Florida to punt the football.
Well, Florida got exactly what they wanted. They read the blitz on the inside. You just flip the ball out to your most elusive player, and he tries to make a move on Ron Darby and can't. And that's why Florida State's defense has been so good. We always talk about Christian Jones.
Florida State up 10-0. Only one timeout to work with as Winston throws complete. Rashad Green stepped out at the 29, so it's a 3-yard gain. All right, let's answer the Aflac trivia question, although I'm really impressed because not only did you get it right, you said 7. You were right about the first 5. Florida State,
yeah.
98,
Florida State,
99,
Miami,
2000.
Yeah. And then the Florida teams from Urban Meyer. That's, yeah. That was a lucky guess, by the way.
No, it wasn't. You cheated. Will it be number 8? Will Florida State get there this year? Got a 10-0 lead on Florida. You're the Gators. You can't give up any more points here going to the locker room. Winston and Benjamin makes another catch. It's a first down at the 41-yard line.
It's the same matchup they had scored the touchdown on. Smart by Jimbo Fisher and Jameis Winston. Come right back to it. Put Benjamin in the slot. And Brian Poole, that matchup is favored to Florida State. Keep coming back to it on the inside slant.
Four catches, 79 yards, and a score for Benjamin. Winston, back shoulder throw, and it's knocked away by Hargraves. Either that or just hit him in the back. Rashad Green, the intended receiver.
Yeah, and Hargraves in perfect position. You take a look at Jameis Winston, his trust in Rashad Green. He's going to start to throw that ball, even though they're covered, hoping that they can back shoulder, go up and make a play, or get the pass interference call.
Florida hasn't been able to get much pressure on Winston the last couple of possessions. Catch made, but not much, as Rashad Green is knocked out of bounds by Hargraves again. So third down, clock running. They have 8 yards to go for the first down. 1 minute remaining in the half. They ruled that he was tackled inbounds. And now a penalty marker. That'll stop the clock with 49 seconds left. Ronald Powell appears to be the guilty man. Jumped into the neutral zone. Didn't appear that he was drawn off by the center, Brian Stork.
Offside on the defense, number 7. That's a 5-yard penalty. It will be third down.
You go from
Florida
third and
State
eight.
Will decline the 10-second runoff.
Third and 8 to third and 3. Florida State declining a 10-second runoff. Obviously, they want time. Third down and 3. Winston with time. And O'Leary comes free to the 29-yard line. Let's check in quickly with Reese in the studio.
All right, Dave, Lex's halftime report coming up. Michigan and Ohio State, an embarrassing fight. We'll show you what happened there. Duke and North Carolina playing back and forth game. Devils trying to get there. We'll see you at halftime.
In about 30 seconds or so, Reese, they've got an injured player down here, so the clock will stop as Cody Riggs, starting safety, is out for Florida. They've lost 14 starters to season-ending injuries, maybe 15 if Trey Burton doesn't return. And Cody Riggs, who made the tackle on the O'Leary catch. What a play by Winston, though. This is the second time you and I have seen him in person. I know we've watched him a lot on TV, but you know, for a guy that's a redshirt freshman, just his accuracy and poise, Brian, is impressive.
Well, and the patience on that last throw to O'Leary. Florida played a little bit of a different coverage. They played a 2-deep man under coverage, which they only can rush 4. And as Winston's been getting hit repeatedly in this game, for him to recognize that, stay in the pocket, be patient, and give O'Leary time to beat man coverage and then throw an accurate ball, that's the kind of maturity and an inflappable approach to the game that Jameis Winston has really surprised Coach Jimbo Fisher with.
He's only played half of the second half snaps, so this will be a rarity today where you would expect, based on the score, that he's going to play deep into the second half, if not the entire game. He has more yards and touchdown passes in the first half than most teams do for entire games this year. Winston on first down, going to the end zone, and Benjamin is wide open. Touchdown, Florida State. In a heartbeat, it's 16-0 after it looked like the Gators might take it to the locker room down just 3.
And that's the backbreaker. Jimbo Fisher, Jameis Winston just refused to let off the gas pedal despite the fact it's been a struggle early in this game for them on the offensive side. They keep throwing the ball down the field, and that aggressive approach nets them a 17-point lead.
The Gator defenders felt that Benjamin pushed off And that's how he got so open down the sideline.
Well, it's been Purifoy almost exclusively. This time it's Roberson, number five, on the outside. Sorry, that's Purifoy again. Yeah, and you can see he gets away with the tug right there. Kelvin Benjamin does. That could have easily been a penalty on the offensive side. You see, they just can't get there. Dante Fowler, and because of that tug, Kelvin Benjamin is wide open.
So the last 10 plays for Florida State, five of them have gone for more than 20 yards. That third down and 26, when they converted that, you got the sense that, okay, Florida State settled down a little bit. And since then, they have looked tremendous on offense. And it was 3-0. It looked like that was going to be the score going to the locker room. And two quick scores by Florida State. And you just wonder, does Florida have enough firepower to get back in the ball game in the second half?
Well, not against this Florida State defense, which has been overlooked in a lot of cases because of how successful their offense is. But this Florida State defense deserves all the credit in the world as well, and it's a big reason why they've had so much success.
And for a while, for a good quarter and a half, Winston was stuck on about 50 yards passing. You look up now, he's got 208 and two touchdowns. Aguayo will kick it away. The last kickoff by him went out of bounds. Scooped up at the 15-yard line. Patton shakes one tackle and brought down at the 35. More college football tonight on ESPN at 7:45. James Franklin and number 5 Missouri taking on Johnny Manziel in 21st. Rated at Texas A&M, then on ABC. Crosstown rivals battle for the victory bell. It's UCLA and USC. Jameis Winston, leading candidate for the Heisman Trophy. It'll be interesting with a decision not expected before voting is in on December 9th, whether there'll be charges against Winston or not, as that ongoing investigation into a sexual assault complaint has not been resolved. It'll be interesting to see if the lack of resolution impacts voters as to whether Winston wins the Heisman Trophy, because based on the numbers on the field, Winston is right now the favorite, the second freshman in a row to win the Heisman Trophy. Let's check in with Tom Luganville, standing by with Jimbo.
Coach, the offense sputtered a little bit there in the first half. What adjustments did you make to get some points on the board and get this thing in gear?
We started getting into our playmaker. We started getting our calls up front, not turning guys loose, giving him a little bit of protection. Now he's got his feet on the ground. He's making the throws, and we're making catches.
What can you do to try and get this offense better field position? You guys have been backed up into a hole much of this first half.
Well, the kickoff. They're getting good kickoff returns, and they get a couple, and they got a great punter. Just win. What we got to do is just be patient, and then when we get it, we got to drive and flip it back and put scores on the board. It'll help.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
Thank you, Tom.
Think about it. They had a 10-play, 28-yard drive going. It ended up being a 12-play, 96-yard drive. And it's 17-0, Florida State at halftime. Stay tuned for the Lexus Halftime Report. In Gainesville, Florida State likely two wins away from a spot in the BCS National Championship game, leading 17-0. Dave Pasch with Brian Greasy and partner for a while. If you're a Seminole fan, you got a little nervous. It was 3-0, third down and 26. The Gators were getting after Jameis Winston, hitting him, sacking him, and then he makes a great play.
Well, he makes a great play, and Kenny Shaw makes a great catch. He gets a big hit from Cody Riggs, and it's interesting. This is the one of the few plays in the first half where Florida didn't play man-to-man coverage. They played a two-deep look, and Jameis reads it and then fires that ball in. And this is really before that play, they only had 55 yards of offense, but that play kind of opened the floodgates. They bring pressure again here. This is the touchdown to Kelvin Benjamin, ISO'd on Brian Poole, the backup defensive back, and he makes a couple guys miss, and that really changed the complexion of the first half.
At that point, Winston had around 44 yards passing. He has 208 now and two touchdowns as he continues to improve on his Heisman campaign. 34 touchdown passes, a single-season school record, breaking Chris Winkie's mark set in his Heisman season of 2000. And Florida State will get the ball to start the second half. Florida, trying to end the season on a positive note, will not be in a bowl game for the first time in 23 seasons. Kermit Whitfield on the return for Florida State and tackled at the 20-yard line. Time now for our Discover Game Changer, brought to you by Discover Card.
And a big surprise here, number 5 from Florida State. They have lived on his arm all year. They supplement with the running attack and Devontae Freeman. But make no mistake, Florida State's offense has been the passing game with Jameis Winston. And I was impressed in the first half, taking these hits, being challenged in the secondary with these cover corners for Florida. Jameis Winston did not flinch. He continued to throw that football.
One of the most accurate quarterbacks in college football, 70% completion rate. Hasn't been in a lot of second halves this year. Starts the second half here. They've been blowing teams out. Freeman gets about 3. Let's get Tom Luganville on here from things from the Florida side.
Well, for the Florida Gators, very disappointing. Trey Burton is out for the rest of this game with a left shoulder injury. And more importantly, they were expecting him to carry the football or have a package that would include him in at least 35 plays. That no longer an option. And talking to Will Muschamp, so goes their season. A 50-yard run, boom, out for the game. And then you start over again on the drawing board.
And they missed a 49-yard field goal on that drive. And now 15 players for Florida. And 10 starters out for the season with injuries. Winston not on the same page that time with O'Leary, so it'll bring up a 3rd down and 6.
And the other thing that Tom was talking with Coach Muschamp about was, listen, his defense, all they know how to do, all they can do in this second half is continue to fire their gun, continue to bring pressure, continue to play tight man-to-man coverage and try to make Jameis Winston make those throws. Expect more of the same in the second half from Florida's defense.
Florida State has been so good, though, on 3rd down all season, and 5 of 7 today on 3rd down. Winston with time. Knocked away. Incomplete. Brian Poole running with Kenny Shaw, and it's a 3 and out.
Well, give Poole credit. He was beaten the first half by Benjamin. Makes a great play in perfect position to make that play on Kenny Shaw. The difference between this play and the touchdown he gave to Kelvin Benjamin, there were 2 safeties back there, and so Poole knows he had help over the top, and he could play underneath Shaw and knock that ball down. That's the difference, quite frankly, between how defenses play Jameis Winston and how they play other mobile quarterbacks. They're not as concerned about him running.
Roberson waiting at the 35-yard line. And there's no running room. Good punt coverage by Florida State, but decent field position for the Gators to start the second half. Here are our first half stats brought to you by iRobot. Florida with 2 sacks on Jameis Winston, but they could not convert a 3rd down. They had 50 of their 104 yards coming in that one play we talked about. And you know, they've scored more than 17 points in a half just once this entire season. So you wonder, with a backup quarterback, really the 3rd-string quarterback, do they have enough firepower to actually get back in the game?
Well, they started the second half how they wanted to, get a 3 and out on defense, and now you got great field position at the 40-yard line for your offense.
Third start for Skyler Morningwick, and he's going to get drilled, and the ball is out. And they have not made a signal yet. It's picked up by Telvin Smith. And it's going to be Florida State ball. Everybody stopped, but the official never blew the play dead. So it's ruled a fumble on the field, forced by Mario Edwards and recovered by Telvin Smith.
Rolling on the field is a fumble recovered by Florida State. First down.
Well, Mario Edwards playing the right defensive end position goes right around the left tackle. That's Max Garcia. Here he is. And the question is, when he hits Morningwick, is his arm coming forward? Does not look like it. That's pretty cut and dry, but that is a fumble. His arm is not. It's still going backwards. That will be a fumble recovered by Florida State.
So it'll be under further review, but has to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the ruling on the field, which is a fumble. And it appeared, as you said, Brian, that the ball is out before the hand motion starts forward. How about that? Just as you said, you get a 3 and out, you get good starting field position, and then you let a guy come running free and cream your quarterback. first play.
You know, Max Garcia started the year as a guard, and they wanted him to be a guard. They had to move him to tackle because DJ Humphreys goes down and Tyler Moore goes down, and so they have to find somebody to play that left tackle position. So you got now, this is how injuries affect your team. And people say, oh, you shouldn't have to, don't use injuries as an excuse. But what you have is a player playing out of position that gives up a big play in a game, and this is how it hurts you.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. First down, Florida State.
Florida State has lived off of turnovers this year. They lead the nation in interceptions. They get a fumble recovery here. Ruling on the field is confirmed. And it's Florida State ball at the 39-yard line. Here's Devontae Freeman trying to pick a hole. Gain of a couple before Neron Ball makes the stop. And you're talking about the injuries. And as you said in the first half, Will Muschamp not making excuses, but it's a big reason why this team's 4-7. And we had Jeremy Foley on the phone with us, the athletic director here, and he said no matter what happens, Will Muschamp is our head coach. He'll be our head coach next year. He said he just has a feeling about Muschamp that he is still the guy to lead this program back to being a national title contender as Benjamin makes another beautiful grab. What a dart thrown by Winston. First down.
This is a big-time arm right here. And again, they go back to the well with Benjamin on pool. This ball is thrown perfectly. Can't walk it out there any better to Benjamin. Good coverage by pool, but this is just too good throwing a catch to defend.
I mean, how many throws have we seen with the defender all over the receiver, yet it's in the perfect spot by Winston. Back to the ground, Freeman. Got a center, Brian Stork, out there trying to block for him. And knocked out of bounds inside the 25-yard line by Jared Davis. And Winston thought there should have been a penalty on Florida, but no flag thrown.
You know, one of the things that we've seen in this game, we haven't seen a whole lot this year against FSU, is a team that's talking, chatting up, talking to Jameis Winston, talking to this offensive line. These Florida defenders have not backed down from Florida State, and first time we've seen Jameis Winston give it back a little bit.
Problem is they got some pressure on them in the first half, but with all their injuries, they don't have the depth to substitute and rotate and keep those defensive linemen fresh. The same guy is playing just about every snap. And now Winston with time, another throw put perfectly into the arms of Nick O'Leary, short of the first down. And really a must stop here for Florida on third down.
This down and distance, third and two, where you bring in Devontae Freeman and the running game. You don't have to throw the ball in this situation. And Florida State will bring in Newberry, their backup tight end, O'Leary, and their fullback, Abram.
They're down and two. And Stork gets bowled over by Darius Cummings. There was movement by Florida State.
Before the snap, false start. On the offense, number 52, 5-yard penalty, third down.
That's why Stork got bowled over, imitated the snap, and that drew a penalty. Now it's third down and seven. Here comes pressure. Winston's pass deflected and incomplete. Dante Fowler was dropping into coverage. Pass broken up. It's fourth down. Jared Davis was in the area as well. Let's see who deflected the pass.
Yeah, it was Jared Davis. A great adjustment from Will Muschamp. You bring the pressure. Florida State has thrown that inside slant almost exclusively against pressure. They scored the touchdown with Benjamin. So what does Will Muschamp do? He drops Jared Davis right in the slant area, and they get a deflection.
Roberto Aguayo made a 49-yarder in the first half. He's missed one field goal all year. He's 16 of 17. And he buries another one. This kid's unbelievable, this freshman. He's made all 80 of his extra points. He's 17 of 18 on field goal kicks. He made his first 70 before a miss this year. That's a school record. Get your NFL Sunday started at 10 a.m. on ESPN with Sunday NFL Countdown. Chris Berman and the gang providing all the latest news and updates from stadiums around the league, and a special feature on Seahawks quarterback Russell Wilson and his bond with a little girl he met on a recent visit to a Seattle Children's Hospital. ESPN 2 Sunday at 11 a.m. It's Fantasy Football Now. Florida State on top of Florida, 20-0, early third quarter. The Gators able to get a stop and force a field goal try. They've gotten stops today, but can they get something started on offense? Might it take a big kickoff return here? Here's Solomon Patton. And Patton across the 30-yard line, out near the 40, so a good return. Here's Reese.
Guys, it is starting to look a little bit like it might be the Duke Blue Devils at Florida State season, the ACC championship game. Now, still a ton of time to go, and you know Duke plays shootouts, but Anthony Boone to Jamison Crowder, and Duke has stretched it out to a two-possession game now, 24-15.
And, of course, Florida State will be in the ACC championship game next week. And if it wins that game and wins today, likelihood it will be in the BCS National Championship game. Look at the numbers for Morningweg. A lot of short passing. They'll run it here. And Kelvin Taylor stood up at the 42-yard line and pushed back by Telvin Smith, Florida State's leading tackler.
I don't think that Florida is going to be able to just line up, turn around, and hand the ball to Kelvin White and blow this Florida State defense off the ball. And I think it's they've got to get Taylor involved in creative ways, whether they snap the ball directly to him, flex him out in the formation, throw the quick screen, get Patton the football, and Valdez Showers. That's the only way they're going to be able to move the ball.
And as Tom reported, with Trey Bird now, that changes things. They had plans for him in the Wildcat. It's a bad snap, and down goes Morningweg as Christian Jones gets to him, takes him down at the 36, a six-yard loss. So third down and long for Florida.
Well, you come out in this game in the first half, and you play with energy and emotion on the defensive side. And on the offensive side, what I really wanted to see, Dave, I wanted to see the seniors for Florida up front. Jonathan Harrison, John Jalapio, and Trey Burton. Those are the seniors that they have on the offensive side. I wanted to see them come out and play with passion. And we've seen now twice Jonathan Harrison has snapped the ball high. Jalapio's been blown off the ball, and Trey Burton is hurt off the sideline. That's why they haven't been able to get anything started on offense.
Now you got to protect to give Morningweg a chance for another high snap. And a short throw to Ahmad Fullwood, but he's not going to get the first down with that. He gets to the 45-yard line. P.J. Williams on the stop. And Florida will send in the punting team. Now, Johnny Townsend had a huge punt in the first half that pinned Florida State at the 4. And it looked like they were going to flip the field, get field position. And the ball back with about 4 minutes left, but Jameis Winston converted on a third down and 26 with a pass to Kenny Shaw. The Noles scored, then tacked on another touchdown. And here we are at 17-0. And Florida State will start its next drive on its 16 midway through the third quarter, leading 20-0.
Winston has had this year. The one that sticks out to me is his accuracy, and he's done it today against man coverage. He's thrown the ball right where it needs to be placed this time to Kelvin Benjamin on an inside slant against man, against zone. He's also been very accurate. Stayed in the pocket. Take a look at this route by Nick O'Leary. There's two zone defenders on the outside. You can't throw him into the defender on the outside. He throws it perfectly on the inside so O'Leary can turn upfield and get those extra yards. Those are the things that are overlooked, in my opinion, about what Jameis Winston has been able to do this year, throwing the ball accurately downfield.
Have you seen a freshman? I know we saw Johnny Manziel last year obviously win the Heisman Trophy, but have you seen a guy with this much arm talent and accuracy and poise to come into college football in a while?
Well, the total package, no. I haven't seen that total package, and it's been impressive.
Going for Kenny Shaw, and well covered, incomplete. Purifoy was down there for Florida.
And I think this is the total package here. We know about the leadership and confidence that he's displayed, right? Check that off. The Clemson game was a big part of that. He's trusted the pockets, had great protection up front, but he stood in there and made the throws. He's patient against zone coverages, aggressive against man coverages to make plays. And then the last part we just talked about, accuracy. Those are the four things that really have been impressive about Jameis Winston, in my opinion, and a big reason why he's been the most outstanding player in college football this year.
Leads the nation in pass efficiency and is on pace to break Russell Wilson's single season record for pass efficiency. Here's Freeman off the right side. It's upended at the 20-yard line. Gain of four. Brian Poole made the tackle, so third down coming up for Florida State. Right now, 5 of 9, 0 for 2 in the second half on third down.
And I think if you were going to put one more thing on that graphic that we found out today is how he deal with adversity, right? You get punched in the mouth from an aggressive, really good, the best defense he's faced so far this year, backed up in situations, and you respond with your offensive teammates in a way that's been impressive.
We asked Jimbo Fisher yesterday how Winston has handled the cloud of the ongoing investigation, and he said, you know, he didn't say anything. He just goes out there and practices and plays, and now here he runs across the 30 and slides to the 33-yard line. So another third down, medium to long, and Florida State picks it up.
No, Greece, I would agree with you 100%. Accuracy is the fundamental essence of the position. But when it comes to evaluating quarterbacks, especially young ones coming out of high school, the competitive temperament, the mental character and the makeup, the mental toughness, all of the things that maybe don't manifest themselves on tape or you can't necessarily see in a camp or combine setting. Oftentimes you may not know about all of those traits that are so critical to success until you get the guy in your program. With Jameis Winston, Jimbo Fisher and staff knew they had the entire package from where it go.
Yet he didn't win the starting job until training camp. He sat and redshirted last year with E.J. Manuel as the quarterback. Winston with a ton of time, gonna let it fly, and Benjamin is there, and he pulls it in inside the 15-yard line. Another perfect throw from Jameis Winston.
You talk about the total package. He moves from one read, wants to throw it to O'Leary, and then peeks outside, and at the last second to be able to fling it out there 65 yards in the air. And Kelvin Benjamin, you give him that much space, and he's just got such a long stride, and the ball is perfectly thrown.
A 56-yard pass. Benjamin with 178 receiving yards. Here's Freeman inside the five. Touchdown, Florida State. And the route is on in Gainesville. The 12th rushing touchdown for Devontae Freeman this season. Another quick drive, 84 yards in a minute 43, just 5 plays. Aguayo, NCAA record for made extra points in a season is 94. And that one just sneaks through the right upright, but he's now 83 of 83. On the year, and it's 27-0 Florida State.
Florida State has done nothing but answer questions this year. The question now everybody wants to ask is how will they match up against a really good defense? And you've seen they can continue to be explosive.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Cadillac. And the new windows. Tweet your Saturday superfan photos to College Game Day for a chance to win a trip to a bowl game.
Shots of the 1998 matchup between Florida and Florida State. The Seminoles won it 23-12. They lead the 2013 edition 27-0. Florida went into Tallahassee and beat the Seminoles last year. Florida State and Florida both played in a BCS game. last year. Seminoles hoping to play the BCS National Championship, while Florida will be out of a bowl game for the first time since 1990. Here's Hargraves on the return for Florida, and he will not make it to the 20. Well, Mark Schlabaugh has been covering the ongoing investigation into a sexual assault complaint that involves Jameis Winston. Let's get the latest from Mark down on the field.
Yeah, guys, the case sits in the hands of Willie Meggs, the state attorney for the Second Judicial Circuit over in Tallahassee. He told me earlier this week that it could be this week or next week before his office decides whether it has sufficient evidence to charge Jameis Winston with a crime. The date keeps getting pushed back in terms of a resolution. Meggs told me the biggest thing right now is his office has a heavy caseload. One of his top assistants is actually set to try a capital murder case this coming week. Tim Jansen, Jameis Winston's attorney, met with Meggs a couple of days ago, tried to see if there was anything they could do to expedite the case. But at this point, it's just up to Meggs to come to a conclusion with this case.
All right, Mark Fulwood with a catch. Might have lost a yard there. And again, no charges filed. Obviously, the status is unchanged for Jameis Winston. And really, the question now is, from a football standpoint, if you have a Heisman vote, it's likely, based on what Mark just told you, that we're not going to know anything new before December 9th at 5 Eastern, when Heisman votes have to be in. So does it impact how you vote, the unknown, if there's a charge, if there's not a charge?
Well, I think if you're a Heisman voter, it's so subjective. Everybody has their different opinions in the way that they vote. As you see that run by Mack Brown, everybody has a different way of voting, and I think it will affect some voters. But if you were to say to a voter, if you just took what happened on the field, I don't think there's anybody in America that can argue that Jameis Winston has had the most outstanding season by a player in college football this year. So based upon that, which we can't deal in innuendo and what may or may not have happened, based on that, I would say he is the overwhelming favorite to win the award.
So even if there's a percentage of voters who decide not to, he may have enough first place votes to win it anyway.
Yeah, absolutely.
Third down and 10. Morningwig in trouble. Gets absolutely hammered, but dumps it off on the screen to Mack Brown. And it's a first down to the 37-yard line. Gain of close to 20, one of the biggest offensive plays for Florida since that 50-yard run by Trey Burton in the opening quarter.
And give Skyler Morningwig credit. He's been battered and bruised in this game. You're going to see the pressure come. He knows he's got the middle screen set up. He's got to take a big hit from Brooks. And he gets that ball out. Mack Brown makes a nice play. The fourth quarter of this game, if I am Will Muschamp, I will be evaluating this quarter in the offseason, maybe more so than any other quarter of football in the 2013 season, to see who wants to fight when the chips are down.
Mack Brown gets to the 40-yard line, so about three there, brought down by Mario Edwards.
And Coach Muschamp has been quoted as talking about those players that want to give supreme effort and energy are the ones that need to sign up to come back next year. If you don't want to do that, then there's no business being back in the Florida football team. And that's why I believe he'll look at this quarter to see, to start to think about next year. Who can I build the future around? And it's got to start with the effort that you're going to give the remainder of this game.
Showers gets the dump off and has room up the sideline into Florida State territory. Knocked out at the 46 after a 14-yard pickup.
Fellas, the most important thing about effort is that it's a reflection of pride, and it takes absolutely no talent to exert it. And I think when you talk about evaluating these players, keep in mind this is going to be right now a Florida 2-deep team on offense and defense that only loses 8 seniors off of the entire 2-deep offensively and defensively. Every facet is being scrutinized, but effort has got to be the signature emblem of this team right now.
Got a first down here, Tom, at the Florida State 46-yard line as they fumble the exchange. It's covered up by the quarterback, Morningwig. My question is, as there is a penalty flag that flies in, Florida here in 3 years under Will Muschamp, the offenses have been bad. They've had two different coordinators. And what do you do to change things up? Do you make a move at the offensive coordinator spot? Do you change the whole offensive staff if you're Will Muschamp? And
after
he did tell
play,
us there'd be changes made.
Conduct, number 22 on the defense. That's a 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
It's on Telvin Smith. Now, Muschamp didn't tell us what those changes would be or what side of the ball those changes would come from. But obviously, they have to do something offensively to put themselves in a position in the SEC to score enough points. When last year was an anomaly, you're not going to go 7-1 in the SEC averaging less than 200 yards offense or whatever it was.
Well, I think a couple things need to happen. And first is to find a quarterback, right? I don't care what scheme you have. You've got to have a quarterback that can pull the trigger. Unfortunately for Florida this year, Jeff Driscoll goes down early with a leg injury, and they've been in tumultuous situation ever since. I don't know if it's Jeff Driscoll. I don't know if it's the freshman Will Grier coming in next year, but that's where it has to start.
Brown wrapped up at the point of attack.
And then Will Muschamp, I think, will learn from this year and learn from last year. And I think loosen the grip a little bit on the offense and let it breathe. Let it be aggressive. Let it be, yes, you may have some quick three and outs in situations and put your defense in more difficult situations, but maybe Will Muschamp learns from this season that I have got to find some offense to go with my defense, because that's the only way I can compete in the SEC.
And movement by several Gators. LaTroy Pittman was the first man to jump in the slot.
Before the play, false start on the offense. Number 76, 5-yard penalty, second down.
But ultimately, this is a performance business, and Brent Pease may end up being the scapegoat. In fact, probably the likelihood is that will happen. But it's not all his fault. Right, you can't put all this on Brent Pease. Certainly, they could have been more innovative. They could have done more. But with the injuries that they've had, it would have been very difficult.
The quarterback, Jeff Driscoll, may be better suited for an offense like they ran when Urban Meyer was here, as Brown is stacked up at the 30-yard line, so he gets about 6 yards. And that has to be something that goes into the thinking for Muschamp. Do I want to get an offensive coordinator who's going to play to the strength of our quarterback, if it is indeed Driscoll next year?
Well, Will Muschamp, without question, is smart enough to know that he's got to build the offense around the strengths of his quarterbacks, all the while masking the weaknesses. But I think it's more than that. I think there's some inner turmoil with Will Muschamp because he so badly wants to base this offensive scheme off of a power run game and physicality at the point of attack. That doesn't mean you can't be innovative, and that doesn't mean that you can't create some flashiness. What they've got to do is recruit better skilled players, and I think they're getting there with last year's class and this coming class.
Here's 3rd and 9 for Skyler Morningwig, and it's complete short of the first down. You would imagine that Florida would go for it here in 4th down at about 4 as Fullwood makes the catch.
I think what Tom was saying there is you got to get those recruits like Ahmad Fullwood just made that catch, who's a big 6'5", 196-pound true freshman that they're really excited about. But if I'm a receiver going to Florida and I see Will Muschamp's a coach, I'm going to have a hard time going to an offense like this.
Going for it here on 4th down and 3 with the play clock at 4. Morningwig throws and it's caught. There's a penalty flag down at the line of scrimmage. LaTroy Pittman, only one catch in the season coming into this game, able to secure the ball. Let's see what the penalty flag is for. The Florida State coaches were jumping up and down on the far sideline.
Illegal formation on the offense. More than 4 in the backfield. That's a 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat, 4th down.
Can't have 5 guys in the backfield. This guy right here, I think it's Dunbar at the top of the screen, has to be on the ball, and they judge that he was off the line of scrimmage there, which allows 5 guys in the backfield, which is a penalty.
So now it's 4th down and 8, but down 27-0. Florida has to go for it. And they're 1 for 9 on 3rd down, and now they got to come up with a conversion on 4th down and 8. Inside 30 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Now we get a timeout called by Florida State. Fourth down and 8 for Florida when we come back.
At WatchESPN.com or download the WatchESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy, Tom Luganville in Gainesville, Florida, trying to end a 6-game losing streak. Florida State trying to march on towards the BCS National Championship. And the Seminoles will play in the ACC title game next week. And if they win today, win that game, they'll be in the BCS National Championship game in Pasadena. Duke was leading North Carolina. If the Blue Devils win, then they'll be the opponent for the Seminoles next week in the ACC title game. On fourth down and 8, Morningwood throws complete for a first down inside the 20-yard line to LaTroy Pittman.
Looking for people that are going to make plays, continue to compete. And LaTroy Pittman matched up against LaMarcus Joyner, one of the better cover corners in college football. Great route by Pittman. And Skylar Morningwood stands in there under pressure. Mario Edwards coming in and makes the throw for a big fourth down conversion.
And that's the end of three quarters. Florida State one quarter away from improving to 12-0 for the first time since the 1999 National Championship season. Start of the fourth quarter in Gainesville. Florida State on top of Florida, 27-0. The Seminoles are number 2 in the BCS standings. The number 3 team, Ohio State, currently on top of Michigan, 28-21. Auburn and Alabama later today. Missouri with one loss, playing Texas A&M. And if the Tigers win, they'll play in the SEC championship game against either Auburn or Alabama.
That'll be interesting tonight. Auburn and Alabama, that front four for Auburn is legit. Dee Ford, Carl Lawson, we saw him a couple of weeks ago. Cyrus Kwanjo and that offensive line, they'll have their hands full trying to protect A.J. McCarron.
Look at this formation here for Florida. They flex out Trenton Brown, a tackle into the slot. And they throw it over the middle, and it gets deflected and broken up. They try a little creativity, probably too late for that. Timmy Jernigan got a hand on the ball.
Well, and everybody's on Brent Peace to have innovation and be, you know, cutting edge. And that was a great formation. It was a great play. They isolated Solomon Patton. He's wide open in the middle of the field. And just they get a tip ball and completion. It's just been that way all year for the Gators.
Another interesting formation here. And here comes a reverse to Taylor inside the 20. Taylor inside the 10. And they're going to say that he stepped out around the 7.5-yard line. First and goal for Florida.
Great misdirection. You snap the ball. A little bit high again from Harrison. You get two lead blockers with Joyer and Morningwig. If I'm Taylor, I'm going to follow Joyer, not the quarterback.
Yeah. One guy's 240. The other guy's about 204.
But this is a guy in Kelvin Taylor that you can build around, right? You can build around some of these younger wide receivers. Ahmad Fullwood. We just saw LaTroy Pittman make a nice play. They've got to find some players up front on the offensive line. And then that quarterback. And
here's Mack Brown on first and goal. He's to the 5-yard line. Second and goal coming up.
And I don't know that you're going to go out there and find another offensive coordinator, but he's still going to have the same pieces. And so it's going to be an interesting offseason in what Will Muschamp decides to do, not only from the decision on who to hire, but how much control does he give him?
You know, I think all the talk here, and it's been rough from what we're told in terms of just the fan backlash directed at Will Muschamp for the season. I mean, you think the guy won 11-2, went to the Sugar Bowl last year, 7-1 in the SEC. As Morningwood throws, it's caught. It's a touchdown. Pulled in by Hunter Joyer, and the Gators are on the board.
That
just going to finish the point that, you know, to think a guy goes to a BCS game 1 year and then he's on the hot seat next year just didn't make a lot of sense. And Jeremy Foley again put that to bed this week. Will Muschamp will be back indeed next year.
No, and that, you know, our conversation with Jeremy Foley was definitely not lip service. It was a feeling in his gut. Again, he's in that foxhole with Will Muschamp, and there are two of them are going to fight to get this thing fixed. And I know it's little solace for Florida fans, a touchdown at the end of this game, but something, some positive momentum to build on with young players for next year for Florida.
You're watching the SEC on ESPN. From Gainesville, Florida State on top of Florida, 27-7. And coming up tonight on ESPN, more SEC action. Missouri with a win will be in the SEC championship game. Johnny Manziel, A&M in Columbia for that game. And then on ABC at 8, it's UCLA and USC.
I'm taking Missouri. I'm taking Missouri. Every week we've been waiting for them, right? Are they going to lose on the road to Ole Miss? They're going to lose to so-and-so. Texas A&M obviously brings in a great challenge. That defense for Missouri, I think, contains Johnny Manziel. And they get a win, James Franklin back, and I couldn't wait to see whether it's Auburn or Alabama in the SEC championship. I think they're going to be given a good game by Missouri.
Kickoff by Florida stays inbounds. And Florida State will have possession around the 20. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
Still unsure who Florida State will play next week in the ACC championship game. Duke up 24-15 late in the third. Marquise Williams to Quinshon Davis. Two-point game, but guess who leads the nation in fourth quarter scoring margin? The Duke Blue Devils, and they're up two.
That staff has done such a good job there at Duke, man, to get them relevant. North Carolina's come on, too. Of late, Larry Fedora and their staff.
Think of the recruiting now for Duke and David Cutcliffe. What, such a great school. Could they become trying to use that Stanford model?
James Wilder bouncing off tacklers at 230 pounds. And he's out to the 44 for about 23 yards. You know, Jimbo Fisher's 42-10 coming into this game in his 4 years at Florida State. And of the storied programs, seems like Florida State above Miami and Notre Dame is back with staying power. Notre Dame, Brian Kelly's done a great job there. They got to the national title game, but clearly not in the class of Alabama. Jimbo Fisher has gotten Florida State to a place where it seems like for years now they're going to be able to compete for national titles as Wilder has stopped at the line of scrimmage. Would you agree with that, Brian?
Absolutely. I think, you know, Jimbo Fisher going back, he took the best of what he learned from Bobby Bowden and Nick Saban, right? And Bobby Bowden was about relationships with his players and with his administration, the fan base. Nick Saban was about building the infrastructure of the program. And I think that Jimbo Fisher has taken both of those guys and brought that mixture to Florida State. It's unlike any other coach that exists right now in college football, in my opinion, and he's got to be in the conversation for Coach of the Year.
Here's Winston on the rollout. And how about that throw? Now the ball comes out after they roll incomplete as Benjamin just dropped it. That's the third drop by Kelvin Benjamin, but my goodness, what a throw rolling left by Jameis Winston. Look at this thing on a rope.
That's not easy to do over a linebacker there, and Kelvin Benjamin just turns his head and tries to run upfield a little bit. But Kelvin Benjamin, if he can iron out the issues of consistency in catching the football, he could be one of the better wide receivers in all of college football.
Three drops, yet he has 176 receiving yards and two touchdowns today. Could have about 300 yards receiving. Winston going to him again, and another perfect throw. Wow.
And Vernon Hargraves, the corner, just puts his hands out and says, I can't be in better position. Look where he is. He's right there. And that ball, again, as you mentioned, perfectly thrown, and it just continues to impress. And I think it's important to make the point, too, about this Florida State team. Offensively, what Jimbo Fisher has done, they came into this year, six new assistant coaches in the offseason. They lost players on the defensive side. Carradine, Bjorn Warner, Xavier Rose, all kinds of players. And it wasn't like it's Alabama just coming in and we're going to reload. There was question marks about this team and the job that they have done. E.J. Manuel, first round pick, you have a new quarterback. who had to win the job. Right. Jimbo Fisher has done nothing but impress with the way he's handled that whole situation.
Late flags come in here. I think the other thing, too, is it proves that you can call plays and still be the head coach. He's shown. Now, they haven't had situations where they really have had to manage the clock late in games because they've been blowing everybody out, but...
Getting a little chippy here late, and Cameron Irving got mixed up with one of the Florida Gators.
Now, we obviously already saw one embarrassing moment in rivalry game at the fight in the Michigan-Ohio State game. And the officials trying to do their part to keep that from happening here.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 75 on the offense. That's a 15-yard penalty. The down count, second down.
Well, this is a rivalry that has had its moments. This is 1998 here in Tallahassee. This is pregame with actually some of the Florida State walk-ons who weren't even dressed getting into the action.
This is look right up here. Talking to Ronald Powell. Obviously, Powell did something that Irving didn't like, and so he got up in his face and made contact, pushed him on the face a little bit, and that's all you got to do. This is the best day, in my opinion, the best day in college football. The rivalry Saturday, right? All these great rivalries, and we've seen it time in and time out. You're going to have these kinds of emotional outbursts from players in these kinds of games.
Wilder on second and 17. Oh, gets picked up and body slammed to the 17-yard line. That's hard to do. Wilder's 230 pounds. A third down coming up. Marcus May with the vicious tackle.
And I think you see physical play and matchups in rivalry games like this. And May, yeah, you're right, you got him up. But when you see the outburst, it's almost like in when the games are blowouts, there's more fight because there's not as much on the line, right? If you're in a tie ball game, you're not going to have personal foul penalties.
Well, I don't know. We had it in Michigan-Ohio State in the first half. Hey, we just showed one from the pregame from Florida State from 15 years ago. And Florida State going to have to call another timeout. Jimbo Fisher upset with his quarterback, Jameis. Whoa, look at him grabbing the mask, trying to teach the young man something. Coach not happy with his quarterback. Clock issues. Jameis Winston unhappy here, but Jimbo Fisher wasn't going to have any of it. Grabs the face mask of his quarterback. Randy Sanders, the quarterback coach there in your picture as well.
Jameis was getting a little mouthy with Randy Sanders in the back, and Jimbo is not going to have anything of it. We forget, I think, that Jameis Winston is still a redshirt freshman playing for the first year in college football, and there's some things he still needs to work on, and obviously his coaching staff, Randy Sanders, Jimbo Fisher, think he needs to work better on being aware of the clock. Three times in this game, it's gone down to a penalty situation, and they're not going to let him skate. The standard is so high for him, and Jimbo Fisher's done a great job of maintaining that.
Third down and five. Winston, and it's caught for a first down. Rashad Green on the grab. It'll be first and goal from inside the 10.
Look at Jameis Winston talking to his offensive line. It's Trey Jackson there. Trust the pocket. That's what we talked about. He's always had good protection the majority of the year. And you see the maturity to deal with your head coach coming, grabbing your face mask, yelling at you, to come back and throw a dart on third down there to get a first down, and then to tell your right guard to quit fighting and quit being chippy. That's what quarterbacks need to do. That's leadership.
Wilder bounces off of one man. And finally goes down at the 5-yard line. Marcus May got him to the ground. Well, Jameis Winston will have one more year that he has to play college football. And you would think with this talent, it's probably just one more year. And with this ability, and there's a penalty flag down. Late flag again.
First down.
Didn't see the flag was on the near side. And Florida State didn't even see it either. Well, illegal shift is the call.
I thought when I was reading some of the clips this week in preparation for this game, the one that stuck out to me came from Kenny Shaw, his wide receiver, who said, as the year has gone on and there's been more attention placed in the direction of Jameis Winston, he's become more and more humble with each week that's gone on. And that's just amazing to me. He's tried to deflect to his teammates. The more attention he gets, it's not about the Heisman for him, it's about winning. That's very impressive for a redshirt freshman to be able to do.
Wilder down to the 11. And Florida still fighting on defense. And again, a little pushing and shoving afterwards. Bobby Hart near on ball getting into it. But this time, no penalty flag. You think about it. You went all this time without a freshman winning the Heisman. Johnny Manziel wins it last year. And Jameis Winston, the leading candidate, make it two straight years with a freshman winning the award.
And it's not by accident, right? With the way that high school coaches are coaching the game in high school with all of the resources that are available, quarterbacks are coming into the college level more prepared to play.
Play action. Winston. Going to tuck it. And bounces off a tackle. Brian, I know you don't have a Heisman vote. If you did, would Jameis Winston be your guy? Would you make a decision not knowing whether there will be a charge against him?
Well, obviously, you have to see what happens next week in the ACC championship game. And if anything comes, obviously, from the district attorney in the next couple of weeks. But if there is not a charge brought against Jameis Winston, I would vote based on what he's done on the field. And based on that, there's no question in my mind that he's been the most outstanding player in college football this season.
Dante Fowler, meanwhile, shaken up.
Oh, and they're looking at that knee.
They've lost so many key players to season-ending injuries, and I know that this is the last game of the year, but I have guys that have significant injuries. It might take you into the spring, too. You don't want to have that, obviously, at the end of the year. You don't get those bowl practices. This will be the first time in 23 years that Florida is not in a bowl game. It looks like Fowler at least is okay, well enough to walk under his own power. He jaws at Bobby Hart on his way out. They were going at it on that drive. I don't have a Heisman vote either, but I'm with you. I think because there, as long as there is no announcement between now and December 9th, I don't know how you can vote when there hasn't been any new information. I don't know how you can not vote him to win the Heisman Trophy based on the numbers. As Will Muschamp is going to call a timeout. Now, the other thing, too, with Florida State, you know, winning this game, obviously, next week against Duke or Virginia Tech, whoever it is in the ACC title game, they win that game. And you're a voter trying to pick the top two teams for the BCS championship. If you don't know the status of Jameis Winston, it's the same thing, right? You got to vote them in the top two.
No, there's no question that the two best teams on the field in college football so far have been Florida State and Alabama. And based on what Alabama does this week against today against Auburn, we're going to see, you know, in the SEC championship. Don't rule out Missouri either. Once sure. They get to the SEC championship, we could be talking about Auburn against Missouri, Alabama against Missouri, and the winner of that game really could play the Florida State Seminoles if they get past the ACC championship.
You know, Ohio State playing Michigan today. The Buckeyes still have Michigan State. Obviously, they're still alive if Florida State should lose next week or if Alabama loses to Auburn. Winston on third down and goal. And Benjamin makes the catch, his third touchdown.
That, I know that won't look like a SportsCenter top 10 play, but what Kelvin Benjamin just did right there, he looked over one shoulder. Take a look. He'll look over his right shoulder first, and then he'll flip all the way around to his left shoulder. That's an unbelievable adjustment. And Kelvin Benjamin has dropped three passes in this game, but he's made a couple of spectacular plays for Jameis Winston.
He has 212 receiving yards and three touchdowns. One of his drops definitely would have been a touchdown. Another one might have been, and then there was one that he laid out for that would have been a 50-yard gain had he pulled it in. Jameis Winston with 327 yards on 19 completions and three touchdowns, all to sophomore Kelvin Benjamin.
ESPN College Football is presented by Cars.com. Get the right car without all the drama. Cars.com, all drive, no drama. And in part by GoPro, the world's most versatile camera. GoPro, be a hero.
more unique views off of our GoPro camera. I think we need to strap one of those to Loogie down on the sideline.
You get some great looks, boys.
Hey, you're in there in the...
I'm a little disappointed that Luganville hasn't been a part of any, you know, been hit by any players down there. He's just not close enough to the field, I guess. We're not on top of the play.
It's the first game he hasn't either sweat or frozen to death this season. Hargraves takes the knee. It'll come out to the 25. Here's Reese in the studio.
Updating the game, Ohio State and Michigan. Buckeyes have pulled out to a 28-21 lead. And Braxton Miller still under 50% passing. It is Jeff Heuermann for the touchdown. And the third-ranked team in the nation, they've stretched it out to a 14-point edge on ABC. North Carolina scored 10 straight points. They lead by one against Duke. Blue Devils need a win to go to the ACC title game.
Where they would play Florida State?
I'm really disappointed that we didn't have any cut-ins when Michigan was actually winning that game. The only cut-in from Reese and the crew back there was when Ohio State was winning the game. That's just... that's poor.
You're seeing bias on the part
poor
of...
poor producing back there in the studio.
Yeah. First down on the Florida 25. Morningwood backing up, and it's incomplete. Let's take a look at this week's BCS standings brought to you by Tostitos. Let's look at the top five. You've got the 2-1 loss teams, Auburn at 4, Missouri at 5, and then the three remaining undefeated, Alabama, Florida State, Ohio State. Northern Illinois is the only other undefeated team. And who has the chance, the best chance to beat this Florida State team?
Yeah, I think it's obvious it's Alabama. And I think it would be a great game. The thing that I would be really interested in seeing is that Alabama offense, right, with Amari Cooper and Christian Jones and their passing game with A.J. McCarron going up against this secondary and this defense for Florida State. I think it would be, it would be the colossal matchup that a lot of people really want to see. And then Florida State's offense against the Alabama defense. Jameis Winston proved to me today that against one of the better defenses in the SEC, against immense pressure in the pocket and tight man-to-man coverage on the back end, that they can still move the ball and score points. So it would be a fantastic matchup.
Third down and 8 after the catch by Pat. Morningwood steps up and... tackled short of the first down by about 3 yards, Tom.
Well, I think you got to look at how Florida State and Alabama have been built. What are the value positions? Quarterback, offensive line, defensive line, and secondary. Those four positions are where Florida State and Alabama have supreme difference makers across the board, and that's why they match up well. The concern with me for an Auburn or a Missouri, even an Ohio State, they have some glaring weaknesses in some areas that Florida State and Alabama could exploit significantly.
Morningwood tackled short of the first down on fourth down. The ball came out and was recovered by Florida State. Nate Andrews with the recovery, so the Seminoles take over. They would have taken over on downs anyway, as he was going to be short. 6:52 left, and it's Florida State ball. Well, I'm not sure that anybody can stop this Florida State offense, even Alabama's defense, which has been terrific the last 2 months. Just Jameis Winston been so impressive. They had that stretch in the first quarter where they were struggling, and then they convert a third down in 26, and it totally changes momentum. ESPN College Football presented by Cars.com. 34-7 Florida State as we watch a 6'4", 230-pound quarterback here. On Monday night, we'll watch two guys who aren't 6'4", 230, but are two of the best in the biz. Russell Wilson, Drew Brees, Saints, Seahawks. Monday night countdown at 6:30. 8:25 kickoff on ESPN in what should be a fantastic game on Monday Night Football.
That might be the game of the year in the NFL. And how many doors have those two guys opened up for those sub-6-foot quarterbacks throughout college football? They're paving the way.
All of our ESPN employees that are from Boston just got upset with you. You didn't pay attention to the Patriots-Broncos game on Sunday, saying that this coming Monday's game could be the best in the NFL as Wilder is inside the 30-yard line.
That was the biggest collapse. I'm from Denver and everybody from Boston.
Florida State in command, leading 34-7 with 6.5 remaining. Jameis Winston adding three more touchdown passes. He's got 35 in the season. We saw a moment during the commercial where in the huddle he started grabbing teammates. Don't know what he was saying, but just showed a great amount of leadership, even with this 27-point lead, just trying to close out the opponent here. First down run by Wilder to the 17-yard line.
I think what that shows you, both from the way that Jimbo Fisher handles his team in the fourth quarter, grabbing Jameis Winston, making sure that he's focused on every single snap, it trickles down to the quarterback. And the quarterback can police and manage on the field, just like Jimbo Fisher does from the sideline. And they're not worried about the result of this game, but they're thinking constantly about the level of expectation, the standard, and where they want to go, and the precipice of where they are and potentially playing for a national championship, and want to get better on every opportunity.
Wilder on first down. Gets to the 15, a gain of a couple. Marcus May on the tackle. As we mentioned, we got Alabama-Auburn today. You got Missouri-Texas A&M. Ohio State, its lead down to 7 in the big game with Michigan. Still about 10 minutes left in that ball game. UCLA-USC tonight on ABC. What was your record against Ohio State when you were in Michigan?
It's pretty good. It's pretty good.
Well, what was it? You know, so just say it.
Well, it was 3-0.
What's it like to play in the biggest game of the year when it's against your chief rival as Florida State runs and Wilder falls down?
You know, it's rivalry games in college football is as good as it gets on any level. And, you know, I played in some rivalry games in the National Football League, Denver and Oakland and Chicago and Green Bay. And, you know, I always look back at the Michigan-Ohio State game that I played in, that my rivalry game, with the fondest memories. And maybe it was because we won, but and it's not just what the game means, it's the memories and the people that you play with, the people that you play against. And I have so much respect for Ohio State and their program, and what Woody Hayes and Bo Schembechler were kind of responsible for building. And so I will always look back on that game and that rivalry, as will all these other players. Florida State rivalry, the Auburn-Alabama, they all have that fond memory, and that's what makes college football so special.
Carlos Williams with a collision with Marcus May. Carlos Williams, a converted safety in season, and this guy ends up averaging 8.5 yards a carry. We didn't see him a lot today. Florida State on fourth down, going to bring on the field goal team, but it's a guy to keep an eye on next year. He'll be a senior. They get all their running backs returning. Most of their receivers are back. Their entire offensive line, except their center, Brian Stork, is back.
Yeah, and that's what Jimbo Fisher said to us last night. He said Carlos Williams will be special. With an offseason to learn the offense a little bit better, he's the one that Jimbo Fisher really has his eye on.
Florida State
had a call timeout because they were late getting an 11th man on the field for a field goal try.
That's Giorgio Newberry, who was late to get on.
So while we have a moment, let's check in with Reese Davis in the studio. Maybe we'll get a positive Michigan update for you here, Reese.
I like it. Reese, yeah, I tell you, this is all for you. 35-21, Devin Gardner's thrown for more than 300 yards today. He'll find Drew Dileo for the touchdown. But, Brian, wait, there's more. Carlos Hyde fumbled. Michigan has it in Ohio State territory, trying to drive for the tie.
You see, when we get a cut in, it's good luck. Good job, Reese.
Obviously, Ohio State is in the Big Ten championship game, but still shot of playing for a BCS national championship. But if they lose in Michigan, that's done. Remember, Urban Meyer's not lost yet as the head coach at Ohio State. The field goal is good from Aguayo, and then makes it 37-7. We've been fortunate all year to have our sideline analyst with us, the national recruiting director for ESPN.com. Wow. Especially over the last 6 weeks with these blowout games, we can get Lugie in here.
He's very official, yeah. National director.
Yep, and tell us about recruiting. So, Tom, take it away.
Well, I think from Florida, guys, obviously it's been a tumultuous year. But from a recruiting standpoint, this is a 10th-ranked class right now. They don't have a lot of numbers because, as we've referenced early, the bulk of this roster is coming back. But where they have made some inroads is continuing to address the needs that they have for offensive skill position players. And I think the two things that are important to note here is, despite the down year, you haven't seen guys jumping out of the third floor of a burning building. They haven't just been scattering to separate themselves from this program. That's number one, and it's important because it shows what Will Muschamp in this program is and how they're perceived. Secondly, though, with the new NCAA recruiting rules, where the extended dead period goes another 2 weeks into January after the last 2 weeks of December, that really limits Florida's ability to close, because essentially they're going to have the first 2 weeks in December and the last 2 weeks of January leading to signing day to close out on this class. So it doesn't give you a lot of time to get the kids in on official visits. So I think things are still positive, but how they close will be a reflection of just how big of a mark this season is.
That's part of the reason Jeremy Foley told us this week that he believes in Will Muschamp, because of the recruiting that he and his staff have done. Touchback. It'll come out to the 25. Get close to all the action wherever you are with the new SportsCenter app. Blazing fast scores, the hottest news and highlights, analysis, and access to your favorite SportsCenter talent 24/7 via Twitter. You can download the new SportsCenter app by calling *SC from your phone.
I think Will Muschamp is an outstanding football coach, defensive coordinator. He's one of the best in the business. And I think that's what Jeremy Foley really sees in him. Now, this is his first opportunity as a head coach, which brings so much more to the table that you have to be on top of. And Will Muschamp is learning. And I think he's able to check his ego enough to know where he needs to learn and grow as a head coach. And a big part of that is the relationships that he's building with these young players. And you know, before the game we saw a part of that. This is him saying this is the last chance for these seniors to go out, and you can see his love for these guys. He's telling them before the game, just go out and have fun. And it's been a tough year, but go have fun. And I think they respond to him.
But Jeremy Foley said when he's had these conversations with Will Muschamp during the season, during this losing streak, as a pass is caught short of a first down by Solomon Patton, he said he doesn't see that deer in the headlights look at all. He sees a coach who's in command, despite the losing, has been able to deflect the criticism. And he and his staff have continued to work hard, even though they have not had the personnel because of injuries. Here's third down and two. Morningwig throws complete. Patton, though, stumbles, and so brings up a fourth down.
And when we talked with Jeremy Foley, asked him how much input or influence will he have if there are coaching changes on the staff in the offseason. And Jeremy Foley said, listen, this is Will Muschamp's show, and it's his responsibility at the end of the day to go find some offense, whether that's a new coordinator or not. It's his job, and Jeremy Foley doesn't want to be a part of that decision because ultimately he needs to hold Will Muschamp accountable to that. And that's, as a fan of Florida, that's what I would want.
Well, in major college football, somebody's going to pay when you lose your last seven games in Florida and you don't go to a bowl game. So there will be changes after a 4-8 season, but it will not be involving the head coach. Fair caught at the 24-yard line. Let's get Tom back in here.
You know, as forthcoming as Jeremy Foley was, the thing that struck a chord with me was, with all of the clutter and everybody having an opinion and telling him what they think should be done, I loved his quote in the sense that you don't make short impulse decisions that could have long-term ramifications. And keeping that type of broad spectrum vision on this program and the belief in Will Muschamp, it's all about not making knee-jerk decisions. And I think that's very important from a position of leadership in Jeremy Foley.
Sean McGuire is in the game at quarterback as Carlos Williams runs here on first down. And pushed out of play near the 28-yard line. Now, the normal backup is Jacob Coker for Florida State, but he is out for the season with a knee injury. So Sean McGuire, whose only scholarship offer other than Florida State was Buffalo.
He Say that again.
The second half against Syracuse and Idaho in blowout wins.
Yeah, and he's been in, obviously, been in the spotlight a little bit in the last couple of weeks for what Jameis Winston's been going through. He would be the next in line. Jimbo Fisher told us last night that he's got confidence in Sean McGuire, and he's got a skill set that really Fisher likes.
And given the uncertainty, as you mentioned, with Winston, who knows, we might see Sean McGuire at some point in the future. So, Tom, tell us about him.
Well, Sean McGuire, you know, we referenced earlier not knowing all the intangible factors that you may need to know when a guy comes out. Sean McGuire was a player that played in the Delaware Wing T, which means he threw the ball 7 to 9 times coming out of high school. So there wasn't a lot of experience, but there was a lot of a physical upside in terms of skill set and arm talent. And that's what Jimbo Fisher likes, to develop a guy and bring him along. He was our 13th ranked quarterback in the 2012 class, 4-star prospect. He's got a bright future, needs to take care of an opportunity if you want one presented himself. And you know what, Dave, as you mentioned, next year could be Jameis's last year.
Carlos Williams on the carry, and that'll be the final play as Florida State led 3-0 for about a quarter and a half, and then Jameis Winston got hot, finishes with 327 yards and 3 touchdown passes, all to Kelvin Benjamin. And the Seminoles have won 13 straight. They're 12-0 this year. First 12-0 record for the Seminoles since they last won the national championship. Will it happen again? They're one victory away from playing for the BCS national championship. They'll face Duke if the Blue Devils hang on to beat North Carolina in the ACC title game next week. Jimbo Fisher standing by with Tom Luganville.
Coach is getting some love here from the family. Much deserved, right, Coach?
It definitely is. I mean, you come down here to Gainesville, it's such a tough place to play, and to finish the season off undefeated. What a credible accomplishment by this football team.
Coach, everybody knows that you're a talented football team. They know Jameis Winston's a difference maker. Take the talent out of it. What is the defining trait of this football team right now?
They care for each other. They play for each other. And no matter what the adversity is, they put their head down, they go to work, and they do exactly what you ask them to do. And they got tremendous toughness and tremendous mental capacity to understand what moment they're in.
When it comes to competing and making an improvement, your quarterback, Jameis Winston, rattled a little bit early, regained his focus, and he seems to thrive on when you jump his tail a little
bit. Oh, he does. Now, he's a competitor. When you get on him and you mount him, and that's what he thrives. That's why we get along so well. We think alike, play alike. We're maybe too much alike.
Hey, have a good one. Good luck.
Thank you, Tom.
All right. All right, Tom, next up for Florida State, the ACC championship game. If the Seminoles win that, the BCS national championship game, more than likely. Florida State rolls today 37-7, beating Florida. The Gators finish 4-8 on the season. Coming up next is college football scoreboard. So long from Gainesville, Florida State beats Florida 37-7.